Hi folks, hope you're okay today. It's good to be with you. We're just sharing the word of God today in Wigan. It says, stand fast therefore in the liberty wherein Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. It says, stand fast therefore in the liberty wherein Christ has made us free. And Christ has made us free. Christ has made us free. Christ can set us free from condemnation. If you feel condemned, if you feel that you have sinned or done something wrong, and you know that you've done something wrong, Jesus Christ can set us free. He says that here in the word, stand fast therefore in the liberty wherein Christ has made us free. There's no liberty in religion. If we try to follow rules and regulations, there's no liberty, there's no freedom in that. So not to stand fast in that. Or drugs. Drugs cannot help you. If you try to stand fast in drugs, it says stand fast in the liberty wherein Christ hath made us free. Christ has made us free in the liberty of his death. When Christ died on that cross, he set us free from the condemnation of sin. The Bible says there is now no condemnation to them that are in Christ, because Christ died on your behalf. The Bible teaches that God is a holy God. The Bible says, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. The angels worship God. The angels say, holy, holy, holy. They worship God and they say that God is holy. Holy, holy, holy. God is a holy God. Because God is a holy God, he cannot look upon sin. Sin is the breaking of God's law. That is sin. When the Bible says, do not lie, and you lie, that is sin. When the Bible says, do not commit adultery, and you sleep around, that's sin. When the Bible says, don't have any other gods before me, and you worship your car or your mobile phone, that is sin. The Bible says, don't use the Lord's name in vain. If you curse and swear, that is a sin. The Bible says that you should honor your father and mother. The Bible says that we should honor the Sabbath day and keep it holy. The Bible says these things. And if we break the commandments of God, then the Bible says the wrath of God abides upon us. The Bible warns us there is a hell. The Bible says the weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Bible says there is a hell. The Bible says if we continue to walk in things that are wrong, we will go to hell. But the Bible also says that Jesus Christ died for your sin. It says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherein Christ has made us free. To stand fast in the liberty where Christ has made us free is to stand fast in the gospel. Paul says in Galatians chapter 1 in the Bible, the Holy Bible, he said, cursed is anyone who preaches not the gospel. Now, the gospel is not of man. Men have ideas how to get to heaven. Men think they can get to heaven by political correctness or religion or their own intelligence or their own ability. But the Bible does not teach that. The Bible teaches that the only way to heaven is to be saved by grace. It says, by grace you are saved in Ephesians. By grace. By the undeserved mercy of God. God offers us mercy that we did not deserve. In the Bible, in Luke chapter 15, the prodigal son left home and he enjoyed his life. He had women and he enjoyed himself, but he spent all that he had and he realized he made a mess of things, and he was there being fed by the pigs. And he said, I'll go back to my father. And he thought when he went back to his father would slap him in the face. No. The father put a ring on his finger and he said, my son was lost, but now is found. Are you lost or are you found today? Are you lost or are you found? If you're going on your own life, rejecting God and trampling the commandments of God, if you're lying, if you're stealing, if you're sleeping around, if you're worshiping anything but God, if you're cursing the name of God, and you might even say, Jay, I'm good. But if you're not believing in Jesus Christ, you're walking on the broad way to hell. There is a narrow way and a broad way. The narrow way is drugs. The narrow way is sex. The narrow way is political correctness. That is the narrow way to hell. But there is a broad way. A broad way to hell. But there is a narrow way to heaven. And that narrow way is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the one that paid the penalty for your sin. Jesus Christ is the one that paid the penalty for your sin. He's the one that paid the penalty for your debt. Stand fast. Therefore, in the liberty wherein Christ has made us free. Some of you are addicted to sin. Some of you are addicted to sin. You're addicted to doing wrong.
Can I ask you a question?
You can. I'm filming. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay.
Question.
Yes.
So, God created us in His perfect image.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And how He wanted us all to be.
Yes. Yes.
Right. So, how is it a sin to be gay?
Because the Bible says. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1, it says that He lets people go their own way and He calls it a sin in Romans chapter 1.
But if He created us in His perfect image, and how He wanted us all to be, and it's in your genetics to be gay, how is it a sin to be gay? Isn't He basically contradicting Himself?
No, you have free will to do what you want. You have free will now to talk to me.
Yeah.
And you have free will to run down the road, to eat chocolate. You have free will. So God gave you the free will to choose.
Yeah.
So you can choose whether to live for Him or live for yourself. Our identity in modern society, our identity is our sexuality. Yeah. But in the Bible, our identity is our relationship to God. In the first identity for you and me is that we're sons and daughters of the living God, not our sexuality.
That,
you know.
But if it's in our genetics and stuff to be gay,
yeah.
Then and He created us in that image and how He wanted us to be, how can they then turn around and say it is a sin?
Well, here's a question then. Is the Bible the Word of God?
To me personally, no.
Right.
I used to go to church and obviously, like, I do have the Bible at home and everything, but...
Yeah, yeah.
To me, no.
Okay.
How does anyone know it was actually His doings? How does anyone know it was actually wrote from His stuff and that it's not been twisted and stuff like that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I really appreciate what you're saying.
Like, there's parts of it I do believe and parts I do stand by. But... Others, like that, they contradict it all.
Yeah, well, I really appreciate the fact that you're talking to me with respect in a civil way and I'm listening to what you're saying.
Because it's polite.
But I would say, like, the moment you said you didn't believe it as the full Word of God is then we've got a clash of that. We've got a clash going on between two different worldviews.
Mm.
My authority is the Bible and your authority is how you feel or culture. You see, and so if you don't believe the Bible, then you can
not
do
not all parts.
But I mean, as the Word, you know, as the Word of God. If you don't believe that, then you're going to have issues. But if you do believe the Bible tells you that your identity, first of all, is that you're a child of God first, before your sexuality, and that's the identity that you need to focus on first. So the Bible says we're new creatures in Christ.
Right.
The Bible says that Christ died. For all sinners, and if you appropriate Christ and trust in Him, then He becomes your identity. I have sexual desires, and those sexual desires I could feed if I wanted to, but I choose not to do that because I ask God to help me, and I try to not let my sexual identity be my identity, but Christ be my identity.
Well,
because He died for me.
Going off that then, why is the all the diseases and stuff like that, like why is all that there?
But if there is no God, if there is no God, life's a bitch and then you die.
Civilization. I need to live. I believe that's true anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
Whether God is there or not.
So asking that question, well, why does God allow suffering and evil? If there is no God, there's no evil, suffering doesn't mean anything. But because suffering does mean something, that's pointing us to God, that we're more than just dust on the edge of the universe, that we're actually human beings, we're more important to God. That's why you suffer, that's why you love, because you're not a piece of dust on the edge of the universe, you're made to be more than that.
No, but why
do you understand what I'm getting at?
Yeah, I get where you're coming from, but it's like, why is everything left?
Why is everything...
Like all the illnesses and everything all you can get.
Well,
why is all that... If God wanted us to go our own way,
yeah,
and he gave us the options to go here, there, whatever, how we wanted to be,
yeah, yeah,
then why are all them there?
Okay,
like,
well,
AIDS, cancer, everything all right, like I'll, that, why are all them there?
Okay, there's a philosopher, if anybody wants to study it, because they'll be listening on the camera, called Alvin Plantinga. He's an American philosopher. And he talked about that this is the universe that could only be, because in this universe, God created us to have love. And when he created Adam and Eve, he created them with a free will to be able to either love God or not love God, either to love each other. But they decided to not love God, and they decided to rebel against him. And so, because he made us with the capacity to love, that is why we have the mess that we have, because in that capacity to love, we also have the capacity to hate. And he could have made us as robots. He could have made Adam and Eve as a robot.
Yeah.
But they would not have been loving, or could love. You see what
right.
I mean? So when they rebelled according to the Bible,
yeah,
if you believe in evolution, no problem. But we believe that God created the world.
Yeah.
And when
yeah,
Adam and Eve was created, yeah, they had the free will to love or to reject, and they rejected. And that unfortunately brought the mess in the world. Now ultimately nobody, no philosopher, no theologian, nobody ultimately knows or has the answer to the problem of evil. Do you remember Job? He went through all that suffering.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I know that my Redeemer liveth. So nobody can fully answer it, but Christianity gives you the resources, because God didn't give you a need. If you had your someone dying in your family,
yeah,
who's really, really suffering, or if you was part of the Jewish people of the Second World War and you'd seen your family slaughtered, and then I came up to you with a PhD and clever and smart and give you a cool answer to the problem of evil, that's not going to help you when you've lost your family.
No.
So can I just finish? So God doesn't give you a neat little philosophical trick.
Yeah.
What he does, he comes down in Jesus Christ and he suffered with us, because when they whipped him, he was suffering for you. When he was on the cross, he was suffering for you and dying for you. So God comes down and suffers for us and demonstrates what it is to live a life of love. He sacrificed his life for us. And that's what he wants you to do. And that's what he wants for you.
If all it stems from is how Adam and Eve could choose to love or rebel and the children's rebel,
yeah,
that doesn't still add up as to why. That's like saying, if I walked over and hit you, then she gets the blame for it. That's like, in a sense, passing it on.
Yeah.
Because it's not saying, that is not saying, why is everything here? Why is there all the diseases and everything like that?
Right.
That's like saying, oh, well, they're here because Adam and Eve rebelled.
But you're looking at it from a modern post-enlightenment culture. If you go to like an African culture, they have chiefs, they have heads.
I've met chiefs, they are really lovely,
you know,
people.
So we're looking at it from a Western modern culture. But if we went to Africa, we'd look at things in a different perspective, or China or Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we're looking back in the Bible and going back to Old Testament culture, you know, Adam was like a chief, he was the head. So
mm-hmm.
whatever he did would bring results for everybody else. And even today we have that kind of idea, like if Trump came to on holiday to Iran and the Iranian president there punched Trump, it wouldn't be a private matter. It would bring two nations to war.
Yeah.
So ahead of a human race has consequences for everybody else. So Adam was like the head. So if you're like thinking from a worldly, rationalistic point of view,
mm-hmm.
it makes sense what you're saying. But if you're willing to like just look at the culture of the Old Testament and allow God to show you that there might be a different perspective.
like I said, it's been like for a
and
lot of it.
I really appreciate the conversation.
Yeah,
you're really
for
nice.
For a lot of it, it is contradicting a lot, and that is my problem with it. I have sat there, I have read it, I have a copy at home. I used to go to church myself,
yeah.
But a lot of it, to me, is contradicting.
But what do you think it's all about, the Christianity or the message of what is what? Why do you think we're here? What we're trying to do? Just out of interest, like.
It's how you see it.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there are times where you can look at the Bible and the bit you read or the bit you go to look for relates, and you do find comfort in it.
Yeah, yeah.
But then there is a lot where it does contradict itself.
Yeah, such as?
Like that. It's a sin to do this, it's a sin to do that. But God created us how we was meant to be. God created us how he wanted us to be, how he wanted us to feel. And yeah, he may give us a choice and path and an option of which one to take. But overall, he wanted us to be like that and do that. And he created us in his image of how he wanted every one of us to be. But yet it's still a sin to do certain things.
Well, I think
that's a big one.
I really appreciate it, and you're really nice to talk to. All I would say is that just to be a bit more open-minded and to just like read the Gospel of John and then read some Christians. Like, if you get a card off Kieran,
I've got one, we can share it.
If you get that card, you'll really find that helpful. Give me an answer. He's a guy who goes to universities in America and he has discussions like this. And all these questions that you have, you can email him. And just invest. All I would say is just be open and investigate, because we're out here today because we want to share the love of God, not to condemn you, but to tell you that Christ gave his life for you and that you can have a new life in him. We all have our issues. I'm not here to judge anybody or condemn anybody. But what I am here to do is, I'm not here to please secular culture or political correctness. I'm here as a messenger to proclaim what God says in his word. And his word says that Christ died for you. And if you turn to him and ask for forgiveness, he'll forgive you, and you'll have this joy and peace. And when you know who you are, you know where you're going and you know what to do. And people are searching for their identity. And sexual identity, there's a lady called Rosemary Butterfield. You can listen to her on Legionnaire Ministries or just Google her. She was a lesbian professor in gay theory. So she lectured in gay theory, she was a lesbian, and she could not stand Christians coming on her university campus preaching. So she wrote an article attacking them. And then a minister wrote to her and said, why are you attacking us? Why don't we just have a rational conversation? So he invited her for dinner. And she thought, wait a minute, he's not as judgmental as I thought. And then he asked her, give me some intellectual defences of your gay identity. And she couldn't give her any rational defence. And this is the thing that I find with most gay people. I'm not condemning them, because my sister's lesbian. But when I ask for a rational defence, I don't get rational defence. You're the most, one of the most rational I've met. Most react emotionally. And all I'm saying is that this lady, she was a lesbian and she lectured in gay theory. She got converted and she's now married to a guy and she's got kids. Now this is a woman who was an absolute intellectual and also had a lesbian lover for many, many years. So all I'm saying is that this culture has its ideologies and its ways, and it says certain ways of behaving are right. But I would say that if you follow the Bible, it's countercultural. And unfortunately, I'm not going to be popular. I'm going to be seen as homophobic, hate-mongering and all the rest. And I know that I know when I come out here, that is the criticism, that is the attack and whatever. But at the end of the day, I'm determined personally to walk in love and to walk in truth. The Bible says that we have to walk in love and truth. Now, if there's a little child here and there's a fire and I don't tell the truth about the fire, I don't really love them. And so culture today talks about love a lot, but it doesn't want to know love and truth. And I'm telling you and sharing with you, I believe the Bible teaches about love and truth. Sometimes truth is hard to take. But the truth is, Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And if you open up to him, you'll find a joy and a peace. It won't be easy. I'm not saying your identity is going to be solved. I'm not saying you're going to have easy answers. I'm not saying you're not going to struggle or you have struggles with your identity or that you'll still like women or whatever, or I'm not saying you or a gay or lesbian person. I'm not saying those will go away straight away or whatever. But what I'm saying is that you'll find a new identity that will give you hope and a future in Jesus Christ. Not only in this life, but the future. Thank you very much. God bless you. And thank you for your time. Thank you. God bless you.